Today on Successful Living.
Won't you come and spend some time?
We give God thanks for this morning right here. Every morning that He gives us, every day that He gives us is a great day. But this morning, where we have the opportunity to celebrate the resurrection, this morning where we get to celebrate life out of death, this morning where we get to celebrate overcoming everything that would have taken us out, this morning where we learn that the stones that came in our life, we get to celebrate that they no longer can stay in our way. Hallelujah. We get to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. The one that intercedes for us day in and day out. 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. The time that He created before time ever existed. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we come before You right now, God, thanking You, God, for the sacrifice that You made, God. God, we thank You for this day that we can rejoice and be glad in, God, because it was You, God, that allowed us to have this day. God, Your sacrifice allowed us to have this day, God, and we thank You for it. God, as we worship and praise You on this resurrection day, God, during this season of resurrection, God, we thank You for the power that lies in us to resurrect any dead thing, God, that You have put in our lives, God. God, to give life back to those things that we have allowed to die, God. God, we thank You right now. God, any dead situations, any dead wants or needs in our life, God, we thank You for Your resurrection power. God, we thank You for getting up, God, and giving us that get up power. Now, God, we ask for Your Spirit, God, to get up in us. God, to run amok in here. God, that we may praise and worship You like never before, God. God, anything that we may have brought in this doors, God, that don't agree with Your Spirit, God, we pray right now in the name of Jesus that it be cast down. God, that we may be able to worship and praise You freely. God, do what You do, God. God, bless the word that is going to come forth today. God, bless the praise, God, that we give You. God, bless the worship, God, that we have for You. God, and we will be mindful, God. We shall be mindful to give You the praise, God. The glory, God. The honor, God, that You so richly deserve, God. And it is in the matchless, magnificent, mighty, majestic name of Jesus the Christ that we pray. Hallelujah. 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 Glory be to God.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God some praise. If you know that He is good, hallelujah. You know that we serve a risen King, hallelujah. God, we come to glorify You on this morning, oh God. You alone are worthy, oh God. Glory to Your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let's just fill this place with God's praise. The word said that we enter His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Hallelujah. We should bless His holy name. Glory to Your name, Jesus. You are alive and well, Father God. Thank You, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to Your name, oh God. Thank You, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. How many know that he's good and his mercy endureth forever? Lord, you are, yeah, yeah, you're good. Hallelujah. Oh, 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 Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good, yeah.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
People from every nation, from generations, we worship you. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Yeah, yeah, we worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. How many know he's good? You are good. So good, so good, yeah. Hallelujah, Lord, you are good, yeah. Oh, Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good, yeah.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
People from every nation.
Every nation and tongue,
from generation to generation, we worship. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Yeah, we worship you, the true and living God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We worship you, Jesus. Who you are, you are good, you are good, so good, so good, yeah. You are good, so good, so good, yeah. How many know he's good all the time? You are good all the time, all the time.
You are good,
Lord, you are.
All the time.
All the time. Yes, you are.
You are good.
You are good. You are, yeah, yeah.
All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
My God is good.
You are good.
You are good. Yeah.
All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
Yeah.
You are good.
Oh, you're a good father.
Oh, yeah.
You're a good, good daddy.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Nobody greater.
So good, so good, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So good, so
you are good.
All the time.
Hallelujah.
All the time.
You are.
You are good.
You are.
You are good.
All Hallelujah.
The time.
You all the time. You are good.
Lord, you.
Yeah. You're a good father. Yes, you are.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth.
Oh,
people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation,
we worship you. For who you are, we worship.
Hallelujah.
When I think about the goodness, for who you are, one more time, we worship you. Yeah, yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are.
For who you are.
There's nobody greater than you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
You're an awesome God.
Hallelujah.
In you, God, we live, we move, and have our being because you are a good God. You are an awesome God, and you're always making a way. You're always making a way, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. We don't deserve it, but you make a way, oh God. We don't deserve it, but you make a way anyhow, oh God. So we thank you, Jesus. We come to just worship you on this Resurrection Sunday because you got up, oh God. You got up with all power, oh God. With all power, Jesus. Glory to your name, oh God. Glory to your name, oh God. Thank you for making a way, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to your name, oh God. You are worthy, oh God, of all the honor, of all the glory, oh God. You are worthy, oh God. You are worthy, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to your name, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you, oh God. Thank you for making a way, oh God.
Don't know how, but you did it.
Yeah, yeah.
Made a way.
Made a way.
Standing here. Not knowing how we'll get through this test. But holding on to faith, you know best. Nothing can catch you by surprise. You got this figured out, and you're watching us now. And when it looks as if we can't win, wrap us in your arms and step in. You made a way when our backs were.
Hallelujah. You made a way, and we're standing here only because you made a, oh, you made a way. Yes, you did, Jesus. We're standing here only because you made, you moved mountains. You caused walls to fall with all power. Yes, you did. Performed miracles. There is nothing that's impossible. And we're standing here only because you made a way. If you know he made a way, just begin to give him a praise. Hallelujah. He made a way for us back on Calvary. Hallelujah. Yes, he did. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, at the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day, 'cause you made a way. You made a way, yeah. And we're standing here only because you made a way. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Glory to your name, O God.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
The Spirit of the living Lord is in this place. Hallelujah.
Glory, God.
On this Resurrection Sunday, I want to just give an opportunity for somebody here who wants to declare to help strengthen somebody else that the Lord made a way for you. Amen. If you want to give a quick testimony on this Easter Resurrection Sunday about how the Lord has made a way, I invite you to come quickly, amen, and share with the view that it will help somebody else in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. When I hear that song, it does something in my heart, because when you're there and you don't realize how God is making a way, he shows you that he will make a way regardless of what's going on. I retired from the military almost a year ago this day, and my pay stopped. Wasn't as necessarily prepared, because I was thinking my pay was going to start right back. So I went about 3 months without pay. He made a way. I didn't miss a mortgage payment because God made a way. I didn't miss a car note. Why? Because God made a way. God puts angels in people's lives, and you don't realize what's going to happen until it happens. I'm not ashamed to say it. My pastor didn't ask for it. He said, son, I understand where you are, because we've all been there once before. I want you to do this, and I want you to continue to do this until you get what you need. I was floored because I didn't ask for it. God stepped in and said, you've been faithful. You've done what I've asked you to do. So there is no reason why I won't do this for you. There's no reason. I didn't ask for it. I was like, God, I know you're going to take care of me. I said what I'm going to tell you this, and I'm going to sit down, because God makes a way. It was always my contention that when I retired, I wanted my mortgage paid. I wanted to be able to not have to work, but through my retirement and whatever other government payment that I was due as a veteran, that I would be able to cover my mortgage. He makes a way. I don't have to work. You know why? Because I said it. I told my daddy what I needed, and he gave me more than what I even asked for. So God makes a way. I'm standing here only that word is important, only because of his grace. He makes a way, amen?
Hallelujah, amen, amen, amen.
A lot of people have heard this before, but my body gives me a fit, but God keeps it working.
Amen.
And when that song was playing, I kept thinking about, he makes a way. My hips hurt, but he makes a way. Whatever I got to do, he makes a way. And so if you're in pain, don't worry about it. He'll make a way. But you got to give it to him. I was doing some work yesterday, and I something kept coming to my mind. When I do what he tells me, I always win. When I don't, I fail every time. So why not do what he say? Because I like winning.
Yes.
And when I do what he say, I win every time. Start thinking that for yourself. When you do what he say, you're going to win every time. Hallelujah. Every time.
Hallelujah.
He made a way. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 One more for the Holy Ghost. Amen.
How you doing, church family? I'd like to say God made a way for me. Thanks to Pastor Bennett and Dwayne. Back in 2008, when I first went to Central Union Mission, these two brothers helped me a lot. They picked me up when they turned me around. They planted my feet on solid ground. And I can say I'm still here because of the success in Central Union Mission. I'm not what I used to be, but I'm going to be more what God wants me to be. And I love you, church family. I love you. If nobody told you they love you this morning, I love you and God love you more. That's why I'm still here.
Hallelujah. For everybody who didn't give a testimony, but you know that you know that you know that he made a way. Come on and bless his name in his house this morning. Glory to God.
Good morning, good morning. I tell you, this is Resurrection Sunday. I know some people been way down. Hey. Been way down, but this, you know, what Jesus went way down, didn't he? But that was on Friday. What's the day? He's way up. He has risen. So that means even if you feel down, you alive, right? If you alive, first of all, I want you to stand up if you alive. I hope everybody can, if you can, stand up. So since you alive this morning, you can actually, you know, do like Sister Faith, the favor does, and thanks, she's already doing it, so let me hurry up, because I don't want her to stop. I want you to know that this is a time that since you alive, we want you to know we glad that we're here today. All of us are glad, starting from our pastors, leadership, everybody. So if you alive today, let somebody know you alive. Go find you somebody to say good morning to. Give them a hug. Let them, this is the time. This is called passing of the peace. God is all about peace. We got a little music coming on, Chris. Go ahead and let somebody know hello this morning. Happy resurrection this morning. How you doing this morning? Have a good week this morning. Ain't God good? Yes, he is. Let's go ahead and just say hello to somebody. Give them a hug this morning. Let them know that you're glad to be here. Let me go over here right now.
Yeah. Here we go.
Whether it's in the courtroom, fighting in the boardroom, trying to feed your family, or kicked out underneath you,
God's able.
God is more than able. You can turn the table.
Turn and tell your neighbor, now it's time for you to find the favor. Can I get a witness?
Just need one more. Services are where he can and cannot sit.
No.
I come here to think if I am troubled.
So do I.
What troubles you?
Nothing that Rome be concerned with.
Everything is Rome's concern.
The Nazarene.
Second thoughts?
Of course not.
Why are you troubled? We're troubled by the same thing. He's out there right now, you know. He's serving the sentence as we speak.
As he should. As he should. He called himself the Messiah.
He called himself King.
He blasphemed against the Almighty.
He mocked Rome.
He challenged the law of Moses.
The law of Caesar.
He didn't respond to the charge.
He was silent.
I asked them,
what shall I do with him?
Put him to death.
They gave the sentence.
Crucify him.
Not I. It was not I.
Not I.
I was simply doing my job.
Fulfilling my duty?
Just doing my job. The day of sentencing, I received an urgent message from my wife. She hadn't sent a communication, and there was a desperation in the words as she carried the fate of Rome in her hands. She warned me that I should have nothing to do with that man. He was innocent, she said. For an entire night, each moment she closed her eyes, she was haunted by dreams, relentless dreams, that warned of an unjust execution, a name that would be uttered with contempt by countless people throughout time, a name that would mean vile executioner, traitor, Pilate.
A woman's hysteria has no bearing on the law.
Yes, yet, well, bleh. In the message, she named him. How did she know his name? Caiaphas, I understand your people honor dreams as prophecy. It was not only, is that only when they fit your purpose? Have you ever received any prophetic warnings in recent days? Have you ever had any dreams? Caiaphas.
I was doing my job, as we both have done.
Yes, yes, we have. Have you ever bent the rules? Have you ever made an exception?
The law is the law. It is not for us to change, to suit our misgivings.
When does the law change? How does it change, Caiaphas? The law must change at least a little from time to time.
Not the law of Moses.
What changes even the strictest laws, Caiaphas? Is it the courage of one person, a person with the power to change the law, to see the injustice that is hidden from others? Who changes the law? What do we do when we are presented with the exception to the rule? Just our jobs? Is that all we do? Your people wait for a Messiah, do they not? Have you rejected the one you seek? His blood will not be on my hands. Do you hear me? Who will have the courage? Not I. Not I.
Today, we have to realize that Jesus has died for our sins, and he is alive. He has risen for us. For us. Did you know that?
I did know that. Did you know that?
I knew that. He died for us, like the whole world.
Yeah, every last person on the earth, in Asia, Canada, United States, everywhere.
Like, that's like a billion plus people. Us,
though, yeah, and
he didn't die for us,
because he died for us, we all celebrate that he died for us. Today he died for us. So we all rise and celebrate the day Jesus Christ was crucified and rose and came back from the dead for us. He came back to free us.
Come on, everybody, get up. Let's celebrate.
Together, the real reason.
He has risen for us, not just for us here, but for us everywhere. Even in the churches, Indonesia, Africa, everywhere.
So as we celebrate, there's a story that we'd like to tell you all.
Clap your hands.
You ready to hear a story?
Celebrate the Savior and his word.
The Savior and his word.
We shall because we know he lives and we are certain. His love has set us free. The enemy is defeated.
Everybody is defeated.
Sickness is defeated. Poverty is defeated.
How many know the enemy is defeated today?
You know what I'm talking about. Understand just why we dance. Let me tell you how this thing went down.
Let him tell you.
New spread so very fast. People came from miles around.
Everywhere.
Man and the
foundation of the world.
Foundation of the world.
Foundation of the world.
They
took my Savior down off of that rugged cross.
Off the rugged cross.
They laid him in a tomb, and said our hope was truly lost.
Okay.
But the third day came on, and it broke the rhythm of life. Yeah, yeah.
Make it noise, you know he broke the rhythm of life.
Broke the rhythm of life. Yeah.
Broke and shattered with his own two hands.
Broke.
Yeah. Something happened that day.
And you know what?
Y'all want to know?
Something amazing. Let's
know here.
If you don't know, let me tell you. The stone was rolled away.
Tell them one more time.
I said the stone was rolled away.
What happened?
And then Jesus stood, big and bad, snapped the keys from that hell in the grave.
Tell them one.
The stone was rolled away. The stone was rolled away.
And
if you know, he came, he lived, he died, he rose. Somebody say it with me.
He came,
he died,
he rose,
he's alive,
heaven,
to the earth,
from the grave,
from the grave. Christ has risen,
Christ has risen just like he said.
Our Lord and Savior,
Lord and Savior, no longer dead.
Rejoice and celebrate, celebrate.
He's alive.
Rejoice, some noise, you know he's alive today. How many are happy that he rose up for all of us today?
Who knows that he said? Who knows that he sacrificed his life for us? He gave up all of our sins. He forgives us all.
Yeah. But the third day came around and it brought the rhythm of life.
Just like he said, our Lord and Savior.
It's a blessed thing to have the next generation taking it into their generation that he lives. He lives. That's not just for today. That's not just for right now. But when you when you get to Wednesday of this week and something goes bad, just realize that he lives. When you get to Friday of this week and something goes bad, just realize and remember that the children, that the babies, that our next generations and generations reminded us that he lives. He's risen. Just like he said. Our Lord and Savior. He's not dead. So today let's rejoice and celebrate. Because he is alive. Hallelujah. 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 Let's stand to our feet and receive our pastors this morning. Amen. The doctors, William and Michelle Bennett. Amen. 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 Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. We came to celebrate a risen Savior. Amen. Let's give him some praise because he's worthy. Worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb. Slain before the foundation of the world for you and for me. Amen. Hallelujah. It is so wonderful to be in the house of the Lord today. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. If I didn't come, I wouldn't see your beautiful faces today. Hallelujah. And I wouldn't see how you know that our Lord lives. I see it on the inside of you. I see it and I heard it in the hearts of our young people this morning. Amen. We tell God, thank you for them. Hallelujah. Because we know he's about a great work. And he's a preparing them for a great assignment. Amen. And we give God praise and glory in advance for what we see today, but for what we are yet to see through our young people. Amen. Oh, it blesses my heart. And I know if it's blessing my heart, I know my Savior is very excited about it today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen, man. Come on, Pastor Bennett.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Everybody.
What a blessing. Our souls rejoice. Amen. In this great, amen, great, great celebration. Let's give God praise for our youth ministry, yeah, our young people. How wonderful. How wonderful. Amen. We just bless the Lord for it. Amen. Amen. It's preaching time. Tell your neighbor, I'm ready for the word. Tell them, in fact, I need a word. Amen. The young people have really given us the message of this season. And it is absolutely just really two things we need to understand. We need to understand that we've got to believe in what Jesus did. You've got to believe in the power of the resurrection. And then you've got to put your trust in him. We've got to believe without a shadow of a doubt. We can't let the enemy get in the way. We can't let the enemy try to make us think that, oh, that's just a whole bunch of stuff. No, that's not it. That's not it. God's word is real. His power is real. And what he has done is real. Amen. And so we want to go right to the word this morning because we want, amen, just to move forward with what God has given us this morning. Amen. You've already greeted one another, but the essence of the message that I want to give you is something that comes out of when I was a young person. When I was a younger person, we used to say to one another, I dare you. Anybody remember that? When you wanted somebody to do something, what you might say is, I dare you. And if it was really something, you might say, I double dare you. I know some of y'all said, I daggone, doggone, daggone, you know, some other things dare you. But I remember that like I remember my name, because that was the sign for you to try to do something that you hadn't done before. I remember standing on Sparky and Ruth's roof, and one of the young people, one of my friends said, I dare you to jump. I dare you to jump. And I looked down, and it looked like it was a mile down. I wasn't way up on top of the real tall high roof. I would have had enough sense not to do that, amen? But I was standing on that garage roof, and he said, I dare you. And y'all know what? I took a leap. And obviously it didn't kill me. But here's what it did. It helped me to conquer some fear that I had that would have stopped me from doing something else to show myself that I could do something that I may have thought I couldn't do. I need somebody to grab that right there. And then I want you, as you get ready to take your seat, I want you to just say to your neighbor, I dare you to believe. Come on, tell the other one, I dare you to believe God. All right, take your seat. I dare you to believe today. The reason that our belief is so critical and so vital is because your believing speaks to your faith. And if you don't have faith, you can't believe God. If you don't have faith, you cannot honor God. And that's because only by faith do we please Him. Only by faith are we able to see the manifestation of what God wants to get done in your life and my life. So if I can't believe God did what the children told us He did, that He rose, then I cannot live in the place of the power of the resurrection. Because if I don't believe He got up, then I might not believe I can get up. If I don't believe that He got up, I might not believe that I can be more than a conqueror. If I don't believe that He got up from the grave, I might not believe that I can get up from the graves that try to entrap me. And there are graves that try to entrap us in our family. There are graves that try to entrap us in our future. There are graves that try to entrap us in our finances. But we have to believe. Tell somebody, you got to believe. Tell them, I dare you to believe. I dare you to believe it can get better. I dare you to believe you can overcome. I dare you to believe you're more than a conqueror. I dare you to believe your situation can turn around. In other words, I dare you to have faith that God can do the unexplainable, the inexplicable, and the absolute greatest thing He could ever do. He showed us by way of coming back from the dead that nothing is too hard for Him. What's trying to hold you down? What's trying to keep you down? Is it something from your past? Is it some terrible mistake you made from the past? May I tell you today right up front that the power of believing what Christ has done, of raising up out of that grave and declaring that I have all power in my hand, in heaven, in earth, below the earth, under the earth, above the earth. What he's saying is I've got the power above the earth. That's in the angelic realm. I've got power in that realm. He's saying, I've got power on the earth, that I have all power. I can control everything in this earth. And he's even saying, I've got power under the earth. That's in the demonic realm. I got power in every dimension of life. I got the power to dispel them demons that are tempting you. I've got the power to break the yoke of whatever is trying to hold you in bondage. I got the power to help you to overcome those bad habits that you know are not pleasing to God, and they get to a point where they're not even pleasing to you. But you need my power. You got to believe that I can do what no other power can do. Now, in a moment, Dr. Michelle is going to come, because not only do you have to believe, you got to trust. You got to trust not that He can, but that He will. So you received an outline to take some notes on. And so the first reason I want to dare you to believe, the first thing I want you to dare to believe, is that everything you and I have ever done wrong, somebody say everything we've ever done wrong is forgiven. Everything, tell your neighbor, they need to get this encouragement, because I'm telling you, let me tell you where the enemy works. The enemy works in trying to bring to your remembrance your past mess ups. And he tries to keep you locked up and in a chain because of what you did. But tell your neighbor, everything you ever did wrong, it's been forgiven. Because of the power of the resurrection. it's been forgiven. Now, that's a good place to give God a little praise break right there. Everything. I better check with some people in here because I might have some people here that don't believe that. But I came by to tell you today, I want you to believe that it's already forgiven. I want you to believe that the enemy cannot hold you in that bondage. I want you to believe that you are special, that you are wonderful, and that it is not a function of what you have done. It is just one thing you have to do. It's called 1 John 1:9. If I confess my sins, he's faithful and just to forgive me, and he will cleanse me of all of that. So get it out of your mind that you're not a good person. Get it out of your mind that you're beyond redemption. Get it out of your mind that you cannot have a breakthrough, because I don't care what it was. Somebody say what it was. You have been forgiven. All the believers in the house, let me see you raise your hand. Amen. 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 You've been forgiven. Amen. Thank you, God. You have been forgiven. Tell your neighbor, it's a done deal. It's a done deal. Somebody get me a handkerchief, please. But not only should you dare, thank you, son. Not only do I dare you to believe that it's done, that you've been forgiven, but I dare you to believe that you absolutely, beyond a shadow of a doubt, can learn how to live in God's purpose for your life. Do you know God doesn't want you to waste your time? And really, your time is God's time. Because God gives you every moment that he gives you. And God does not want you wasting your time. Do I have any above 40 folk in here like me that are so don't want to waste no more of your time? You realize how valuable it is? You realize how fast it goes? You realize that maybe you got more time behind you than you got ahead of you? And you don't want to waste any more of your time. Don't want to mess with no foolish folk. Don't want to mess with no foolish habits. Don't want to mess with no naysayers. Don't want to mess with no negative, stinking, thinking people. Ain't got no time for it. Don't want to mess with no dream stealers and robbers. When you learn how to believe, and I dare you to believe, I dare you to believe what God did through the resurrection, it will cause you to focus more on your purpose. And you will realize that God still got something for you to do. I say it almost every week because your life is tied to your purpose. And so at the risk of repeating myself, if you still got breath in your body, God's got a purpose for you. And it's not to waste your precious time with stuff that does not matter. Your purpose can only come from God. You and I cannot create our own purpose because we didn't make ourselves. So we have to talk to the Creator and let the Creator make it clear what our purpose is. And I dare you to believe that if you talk to him, he will answer you. And he'll begin to direct your path, order your steps, and show you what you're supposed to be focusing on, and he'll show you what you're not supposed to be doing. Stay with me, and I don't care how much of a habit it has become. If it's not what you're supposed to be doing, the God I serve with all power will bring it to your mind and tell you this is not what you should be doing, just like Pilate's wife did. Pilate's wife had a dream, and said, you better leave that man alone because that man has not done anything wrong. God will show you who you don't need to be hanging out with. He'll show you who you need to be hanging out with. Any of y'all ever had that moment when you were trying to go to Bedside Baptist or TV Tabernacle and the Lord told you to get your behind up out the bed and get yourself to church because you can't get at TV Tabernacle what you got in here today? You can't get that. You got to be in the presence because his word says, hey, Acts 20, don't forsake the assembling of yourself together. He tell you, get yourself, you being lazy. Y'all done got quiet on me. But that's God trying to direct you towards purpose. You spend 168 hours a week. So maybe you spend 164 hours a week out in the world. You need to be in the house of the Lord so you can hear. Amen. In his house where he said he dwells, he'll dwell in his tabernacle. He'll dwell in your praise and your worship, but it's something special when we come together. Otherwise, God wouldn't have said you got to come to church. And Jesus would not have been the model because he was in church all the time. And so, if you dare believe, you can discover God's purpose so you don't waste your time because you will be wasting your life. How many of y'all spend time in a relationship after you thought about it, say, I should have never gave that man or that woman all them time. I knew from the beginning. Y'all don't want to talk to me on Easter Sunday morning. For the guest in the house, I'm just a keep it real preacher. Amen. I'm not going to try to give and espouse to you theological theorems without making it applicable to your life. God doesn't want you to waste your time. God wants you to fulfill your purpose in this earth realm. He doesn't want you tied up in stuff that's not his purpose. And so many people, unfortunately, the reason they waste their time is because they are confused about two things. They're confused about their identity and they're confused about their purpose. They don't know who they are. So that's why anybody can be influenced. Everybody, people can be influenced. When you don't know who you are, people can try to tell you who you are. But you can only get your identity from God. What you've got to do is believe. I dare you to believe that you are who God says you are. Not what somebody who didn't mean you any good said to you. Not anybody who may have been a dysfunctional parent and said, you ain't gonna never be nothing. Your daddy wasn't nothing. Your mama was. You ain't gonna never be. I dare you to believe they were a lie. The truth wasn't in them. You are who God says you are. You are fearfully, wonderfully made. You are marvelously made. You are special and you are more than a conqueror because the greater one is in you, believer. Don't you get your identity confused. You are who God says you are. But you got to walk in who he says you are. Y'all ever had somebody try to influence you to do something and be something you weren't? You ever had folks just trying to influence? You trying to grow in the Lord. They trying to, let's go to the club. Let's go to the club. They're trying to influence you to be something you're no longer. Because then you go ahead and give in. And you're sitting up in there trying to be like the old days. And you are like, what in the heaven am I doing in here? I don't fit no more. That's not who I am anymore. God's trying to transform me, trying to change me. And I got folk trying to pull me back into the old way. No, it's not my purpose anymore. I ain't hitting and hiding and talking and poking no more. That's not who I am. I ain't slipping and sliding and hipping and hiding and dipping and dabbing and talking and poking. I ain't doing that no more. Because I know God's called me out of that. It's not my purpose. I want to walk in my purpose. I dare you to believe. And the purpose God has for you. Thirdly, so I can let Michelle Warhorse Preacher come on up here. I dare you to believe I dare you to believe that God will give you the strength you need to live your life every day in victory. I'm going to say that again. I dare you to believe that God will give you the strength you need every day to live your life in victory. You are created to live in victory. You are more than a conqueror. I'm telling you, you need God's power to help you to live. And you got to believe that you have got His strength. How many of y'all have lived long enough to know that your power, your willpower, will run out? But I'm telling you, when you begin to live your life in the power of God, He's got something I like to call that something extra. When it looked like you're just getting to the end of your power, He got an extra gear, and it's called the faith gear. That faith gear will kick in. And when you didn't think you could make it, when you didn't think you could make another moment, when the child had gotten on your last nerve, you felt like picking them up and killing them yourself. God made you calm down and say, now, baby, we got to get this straight. That's not how we're going to operate. And I tell you, God's got another gear. He'll give you strength. When that mean, ugly acting boss has gotten on your last nerve and you want to tell them, take this job, and He'll tell you to shut up and be still, for you be in the unemployment line. He'll tell you, I'm growing you through this trial. I'm growing you through these folk that have gotten on your last nerve. You don't build no muscles doing weak stuff. You got to build muscles dealing with some heavyweight stuff. Do I have a witness here? God will give you strength. And if you want transformation in your life, if you want miracles in your life, if you want to see the power of God working in your life, you have got to understand that God is the power source. That's why you get up and pray, so He can give you power. That's why you got to tune into the Holy Ghost, because He says, after you have received the Holy Ghost, you shall receive power. You need the power to resist some of these demons out here today. You need the power of God to resist some of these temptations that are out here. You got to get plugged into the power source. I don't care how much you spend for the toaster if it's not plugged into the power source and not going to do what it's supposed to do. I don't care how big the refrigerator is, got three sides to it, open the door, push the outside door, can open up, they ain't got to go in the whole refrigerator. I don't care how much it's got, if it ain't plugged in, you got no power. You got to believe the power that worketh within you is greater than anything you face. Sometimes the reason that you're always tired is because all you're doing is trying to live life by your power. That's why you're tired. But can I give you some good news before I let the war horse come up here? Your life will never be all it could be and all God wants it to be until it gets plugged in to the power source. It's never going to be. You're never going to be all He wants you to be until you get plugged in to the power. I just may as well tell you, your marriage is never going to be all God wants it to be until you get plugged into the power source. Your money ain't going to all be all God wants it to be. I don't care if you got a whole bunch of it. It won't be what God wants it to be until you get plugged into the power source, where He's in charge of even what you got, and you ain't walking around here like, I got this and I got that and that. Because I'm going to tell you something. In case you don't know it, it can be here today. I don't care how much insurance you got. That's why I love what the Word says. I'm going to get out the way. But Isaiah declared, it's on your outline, "Hast thou not heard, and hast thou not known, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator," listen, "of the ends of the earth," he made everything. This God, neither faints nor is he weary. Now stay with me. I dare you to believe that his power is your power. Because if his power is your power, then what that means is when you would faint, he's got power that would cause you not to faint. Let me make that hermeneutic, the application. When you would give in to that temptation, his power can help you not give in to that temptation. When you would cuss and fuss, his power will make you pray and believe God to change the situation. When you would do something you know you ain't got no business doing, his power will cause you to stop like a red light. That's why Isaiah said, he neither faints nor gets weary. But he goes on to say this, there is no searching of his understanding. Wake your neighbor up, tell him, hang in here, don't miss this. There's no searching of his understanding. In other words, you will never fully comprehend the mind of Christ. But what you've got to do is you got to believe, and I dare you to believe him, that what he said in this word is true, and he'll do what he said he would do. He goes on to say, he gives power to the weak. To them that have no might, he increases strength. Come on, somebody, do like this. He increases strength. That's what he said he would do. And if you're plugged into him, he will absolutely give you strength. And then he said a word for the young people. He said, even the young, Janiah, he said, even the youth shall grow weary. And the young people shall, some of them shall utterly fall. But then he said, but they that wait upon the Lord. I like that because upon, we say upon, but really it means if I get up on him. If I'm all up on him, come here, big boy. Come here. If I get all up on God, amen. I ain't just with God like this. Hey, God, you all right with me? I'm all up on God. If I get all up on God, amen. If you come this way, God got you. If you come this way, God got you. If you come this way, God will help me to see it. They that wait upon the Lord, thank you, son, shall renew their strength. And then what you'll be able to do is you'll be able to mount up with wings like an eagle. I feel like preaching. Lord have mercy. Can y'all do like this? Just like this, like an eagle. You ain't no little chicken. You are an eagle. You can rise above whatever comes. You can rise so high that some of the enemies can't even get to you, because there's a place where the eagles fly that the chickens can't go and the crows can't go. There is a place where you can rise into God and you'll declare, come what may, whatever betide me, God will take care of me. Do I have anybody that knows what I'm talking about? Won't he do it for you? Yes, he will. He'll hide you in his pavilion. He'll hide you so what tried to get you can't get to you. That's the kind of God that we serve. I ain't finished, but plug into the power source. And if you will believe him, I dare you to trust him. I dare you to put your trust in him. And that's what Dr. Michelle's going to tell you. How do you do it?
Hallelujah. I love the word of God, and we know that Hebrews 11 talks about faith being the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Amen. He said, without faith, it is impossible to please my God. And so how do I come to God without faith? I can't come to him without faith because I won't believe that he is. and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Hallelujah. So today we celebrate a risen Savior. But how did I come to know this Savior? I had to come to know him by faith. He drew me by faith, and then he poured his grace on me, and then his grace and mercy showed me that God is good, and that this faith, that this salvation is a gift from God, and I can't earn it. It's a gift from Almighty God. Because if I think I did it, I might boast in this thing. Hallelujah. And so we celebrate a risen Savior who laid his life down for you and me. Hallelujah. They said the Roman soldiers took his life, but they didn't take his life. He did it on purpose. He was born to die for you and for me. Hallelujah. And that's why these kids celebrate. And he is alive and he's a well. And if he's not alive and well, then why are we here today? That means that our salvation is not for real. It's null and void, but the devil is a liar. Hallelujah. Let me just share a little bit of scripture with you. Hallelujah. We know Jesus is the living word, but I'm going to share a little bit of the written word with you. Now, we know that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John recorded the resurrection story. For some reason in my studies, I was drawn to Mark's account. And so let's look at Mark chapter 16, starting at verse 1. When you're ready, say, Resurrection Sunday. Hallelujah. Not ready yet. Glory to God. Mark chapter 16, Matthew, Mark, the second book of the New Testament. Jesus has risen. I'm reading from the NIV version. And it says, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go anoint Jesus' body. It was very early on the first day of the week after sunrise. They were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb? But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away already. And as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. He said, don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go tell his disciples and Peter. He is going ahead of you into Galilee, and there you will see him just as he told you. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb, and they said nothing to anybody because they were afraid. I submit to you, I want to focus on a little bit right now how who rolled away the stone. They talking amongst one another. One thing I like about Mark's account is that he had these women coming to his tomb. Jesus had made such an impression on the women, and they loved him so much. I mean, Mary Magdalene had been delivered from 7 demons. You know she loved Jesus. She was free now. He said, he who the sun sets free is free indeed. And then Mary, the mother of James and Salome, they all came together and they were conversing with one another and they were saying, who will roll away the big tombstone that they put in front of the tombs? And when they got there, to their surprise, the stone was already rolled away. You know who rolled away the stone? Jesus rolled away the stone. Trey wrapped it this morning. He said the stone was rolled away. Hey, the stone was rolled away. And there Jesus stood, big and bad, snatching the keys of death, hell, and the grave. The stone was rolled away. And now the enemy is under Jesus' feet. And if he's under Jesus' feet, he's under your feet, he's under my feet, and he's under your feet. You see what Jesus did? He rolled the stone of sin away. That sin was blocking me and you from our heavenly Father. And God didn't want it like that. He loves us so unconditionally that he wanted relationship. He knew we were going to fall, but he had a plan to reunite us with him. And so when that stone was rolled away, we have reconciliation with Almighty God. Jesus came to die to move the stone of sin. The veil was rent when he died. And so now I can go to Jesus on my own. I don't need no high priest. I don't need to go to confessional and say, bless me, Father, for I have sinned. Because I got direct access, if I'm a believer, to my heavenly Father. The veil was rent when the stone was rolled away. And now he said in 1 John 1:9, if I confess my sin, that he is faithful and just to forgive me of all my sin and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I can go to God 24/7 and repent and ask him to forgive me of my sin, and he'll do it. Pastor Bennett talked about it best. The major problem with the believer today is that we got an identity crisis. We don't know who we are in Christ Jesus. And if we come to believe him, that's how we get our identity back. The stone was rolled away because God wants us to know who we are in him. And I'm telling you, we celebrate because if he got up, I can get out of any situation that the devil throws my way. And believe me, when I come to Jesus, I've engaged myself. I've enlisted in a war. But see, the weapons of my warfare, they are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And I'm going to let you know something. If you have a relationship with God and the devil is not on your trail, then you might have to question if you really are a believer. I'm telling you, because when you are a threat to the enemy, he's going to raise up more smoke screens than he can ever do to try to distract you. But Jesus rolled away the stone of distraction. And so what he did was he took poverty so that I might be wealthy. He took sickness so that I might be healthy. He took death that I might have eternal life. He took all my sins upon him, my past sins, my present sins, and my future sins. And now I have new life and I'm united in Christ Jesus. Paul talked about it in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. He said that I might know him, hallelujah, in the power of his resurrection and in the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. That's what happens with the believer. We come to know him. He said, I want you to believe in me so that you can know me. You know, sometimes we have some problems. Just because you come to Jesus doesn't mean that you're going to be problem free. If anything, you enlisted in a war now. But you got to remember, because the stone was rolled away and Jesus came to put enemy under your feet, that you win already. Because you're united with him. He overcame the world and he lives on the inside of you and me. And so we overcome the world with the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Jesus is the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. And so don't worry about your problems and your predicaments. Jesus told us all about it. He said it in John 16:33, in this world you will have tribulation. But then he said, but be of good cheer because I've overcome the world. And if I can overcome it, then you overcome it. And so as believers, you got to know who you are in Jesus. When you believe him, you're an overcomer. And so you don't get upset when the enemy throws his tactics at you. You're wise enough to recognize that it's him blowing a smoke screen up in your face. And when you rest in God, you know what's going on. I saw that movie, The Shack. And they had people depicting Jesus, the Holy Ghost, and God the Father. But it was something about hanging out with Jesus. I mean, we could just relate to him. I mean, you're looking at it on the screen, and you just feel so relaxed. You can take your shoes off. You can crack a joke. You can be yourself. But the thing is, the man got on the water, and all this black oil started coming up under the from the in the bottom of the boat. And the boat started shaking and rocking, and he had the oil on his hand, and he started to panic and panic. And then he saw the face of Jesus, and Jesus told him, keep your eyes on me. Because see, the word scripture, the Bible tells us, if I keep my mind on Jesus, he'll keep me in perfect peace. And so once God got Jesus got his attention, the oil dissipated, the boat stopped rocking, the waves stopped roaring, the sun came up, and it was like, peace, be still. When I saw that scene, it made me think about when I'm going through some rough times, when it looks bleak, when it looks dark, when it looks gray, when I don't know my way out, when I see the black oil coming up and the devil wants me to look at it and he wants me to think that he got me trapped and down in a hole, that I can look to my Jesus, because when I believe in my Jesus, the bright light comes on. Everything is at peace. All hell can be breaking loose. And they wonder, why are you so happy? Why are you singing a song? Why are you praising God? Why are you taking your shoes off? Why are you hallelujah? Because you don't know, like I know, what he's done for me. He's brought me a mighty, mighty long way. And I believe what he said in John chapter 15, apart from him, I'm nothing. But he's done awesome things. With him, I can do all things through Christ. I'm a little timid girl. Do I look like I used to be timid? Ask her. Little timid girl. All the time. But I'm telling you, when God comes in your life, he will make you bold for him. When you come to know who he is, you can't get mad at the gift on the inside of people, because God wants to use them the way he wants to use them. He gonna got something to put the salve on. He got something to be forthright. He got something to hug you and wipe the snot. But I'm just telling you, every gift is needed. He got something that's gonna whip you into shape, that wanna propel you into your destiny. It ain't that they don't have the love of God, but they trust God and they know that their call is to propel you into your destiny. You see, the enemy want us paralyzed. He want us to think that he's the one that's in control. But God's in control. And when we go forth anyway, when we know who we are, we put him under our feet. That's why Jesus came to die. He died and he lived victoriously for you and for me. And so we've got to believe and trust in God. When you're going through, what did he say in 1 Peter 5 and 7? He said, cast your cares upon me because I care for you. What does it mean to cast my cares, Pastor Bennett? What does it mean for me to cast? It means for me to throw forcefully. God said, throw it at me forcefully. I'm God. I can handle it. That was never your burden to bear in the first place. Cast your care. And then we got to practice Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. He said, trust in me with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge me, and I'm going to direct your path. He said, trust in me with all, not part of your heart, not sometimes, not in September and not in December, not when the baby is little and not when the baby, but when the baby is 15 and 16 and I'm scared because I don't know whether he know what he's doing. All your heart. And then he said, lean not to your own understanding. You know why I can't rely on my understanding? Because it's too small. It's limited. It's finite. I can put it in a box. But my God is infinitely wise. And if I know that he's infinitely wise, then I can trust in him. I can turn everything over to him. I can relax in his love. My God, what confidence it gives me to know that he's infinitely wise. He's a good, good father. He knows the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. He's got it all figured out. We're just rewriting the story that he already wrote. It's his plan. And they're not to harm me, but they're to perfect me and to prosper me and to give me a hope and an expected end. But see, if I don't know the word, I don't know this. I don't know his promises. I surely don't know what his commandments are. But when I obey those commandments, hallelujah, when I obey him, it's going to make my life easier. People don't get it. And I know this is a tough one. Say no premarital sex. You know why? Because he want to protect you. You know, people come up pregnant and they don't want to be pregnant. They ain't married to nobody. They don't even have no job. Most of our little girls right now getting pregnant because they don't know who they are. They don't know who God is. They don't know who their good father is, perfect in all his ways to them. And it has nothing to do with who their biological father was, because sometimes we got some deadbeat dads and we got some moms strung out on crack cocaine because she can't handle it. But see, what will happen is the Holy Ghost will meet them in their house. The little baby will come up in this church and grab hold of this word. And God will use that to show them who they are. And they'll grow up, they said, and a child shall lead them. Hallelujah. You ever seen people who come from the wrong side of the track and you never thought they wasn't going to be nothing? Their mama wasn't nothing. Their daddy wasn't nothing. Their grandmama was on food stamps. Their mama was on food stamps too. She got in line, was waiting for some handouts. But this one said, not me. The buck stops right here. You know why it stopped right there? Because she believed in a risen Savior. The Holy Ghost got a hold of her and she got a hold of the Holy Ghost. And she said, the buck stops here. It will not. It's over. It's over. That's what some of us got to do. You see this generational mess going on in our families? Everybody getting pregnant, ain't married to nobody. Everybody dropping out of school. Everybody on ADHD medicine. All of this. The buck stops here. Jesus came that I might be healed, that I might be whole. Nothing missing, nothing broken. And you see, nothing is too hard for our God. All things are possible if I just believe it. And all it takes is faith the size of a mustard seed. And we said we can move the mountain. We got mountain moving faith, but you got to know who you are in the name of Jesus. And I'm telling you, the more God uses you, the more the devil want to mess with you. But then you know you're on the right track. He said, acknowledge me in all your ways. Tell me about it. Praise me in the midst of the storm. Get up early in the morning and pray over yourself and plead the blood over your babies and worship me in spirit and truth and put your ear to my lips so you can hear a word from me, because I want to give you some instructions. I want to remind you that you're the apple of my eye in the name of Jesus, that I cherish you, that I love you unconditionally, that there's nothing that can separate me from you from my love. Not angels, nor demons, nor death, nor life, nor evil principalities. You can go up high, you ain't separated. You can go down low, you're not separated from me. Hallelujah. But see, if I don't spend time with him, I don't know that. And see, the devil gets excited when you don't know that. Because see, it's easier for him to whip your tail. But see, the thing is, the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal, but they're mighty through God. We pray, we use the word, we fast. We decree and we declare a thing, and it will be established. And so what we do is we turn it all over. We relax in his love because he is love. Think about it. He can't love you no more than he loves you right now. And he can't love you no less than he loves you right now. And so when you know that, oh my God, it makes me so confident. See, he'll use a little timid somebody like Gideon or like me and do a mighty work. Turn him into a mighty man of valor. Turn him into a mighty woman of God, a warrior woman, pulling down strongholds. Hallelujah. And so you got to turn it over to him. You got to relax in his love. And then you got to be used to serve God by serving others. So what happens if I say I'm a believer and I have no desire to serve Jesus Christ? I have no interest in what I can do for humanity. I have no interest in helping nobody else. Then I got to ask myself, am I really a believer? Hallelujah. So it's T-R-U-S. This one's can be a hard one, because you might have to suffer for doing what's right. If Jesus was persecuted for doing right, he spoke truth and they killed him. He was a perfect man. That's why he could die for me and you. That's why he could be the ransom that was paid. Don't think he's not going to persecute you. And so we can't just be wimps. We expect it. But we have to remember we win. And we are victorious even in that. People will ostracize themselves from you. They will criticize you. They'll call you a holy roller, a fanatic. The devil is a liar, because all along Jesus is just blessing me. He just blessing me. And we wrestle not against flesh and blood. It's not the person, but it's the spirit that the person is agreeing with. And you got to be able to see that and take authority over it and ignore it. Amen? And so we said, we want to use our life to serve others while we're serving God, suffer for doing what is right, and T, the last T, is I've got to trust in what he says. You know, people ask, what is it that God cannot do? You know, we say he can do all things. God can't lie. He honors his word above his name. He is not a man that he should lie. Oh, my God, with confidence, I lie to you. The newspaper, the radio, the media. And I don't like lying, and I don't like people that lie to me, but I ain't got it all together. But there is one that you can depend on. To the one who is spirit and truth all the time, 24/7. You can trust in him.
This concludes today's broadcast of Successful Living. And remember, if you meditate on the word day and night, you will make your way prosperous, and you will have good success.